Bowling fans are back. Lake Geneva Lanes is the site this time. We've got another trios tournament like we saw by you in New Berlin, Dwight, but this time we got the big kids playing with the Kunes Country 2+1 trios. Four good teams out there, solid teams from Wisconsin and Illinois, but our top seeded team, Team Eagle, really looking to get off the schneid, second place the last 2 years and looking to win one.
On paper, Phil, very, very strong team. Jaime Cullen, Rob Milbrath, and Jerry make up a very strong team. You would think that they are the favorites going in.
We got great bowling action for you today from Lake Geneva Lanes. Join Dwight and I back for our opening match after this short commercial break.
It's Kunes Country Ford Lincoln's Swap Your Ride sales event.
We have the state line area's biggest selection of cars, trucks, and SUVs, period.
Plus, we have over 750 pre-owned vehicles in our exclusive No Fear certified program.
Swap Your Ride savings up to $5,000, plus 0% financing on most models.
We are paying top Kelley Blue Book values for your trade, and we'll buy your car, even if you don't buy ours.
It's Kunes Country Ford Lincoln's Swap Your Ride sales event.
Lake Geneva Lanes is the place. The Kunes Country 2+1 trios are opening match. And Dwight, we've got someone you're pretty familiar with from the days in the Coors Light All-Star Leagues with Shirley Stahl leading things off on lane 13.
Yeah, I was proud to be a part of that, and Shirley has always been, and I always will remember her to be, one of the strongest lady bowlers in the area, in the city. Strong physical game, a lot of rotation and turn on the ball. Been with Jim for many, many years. Jim's been very supportive, drills a lot of her stuff up, and a little high on that one, Phil.
Yeah, a little tug, little nerves. Hard to believe all these years from talking to her beforehand. This is the first time she's ever been on TV, so
amazing.
All the experience she's had under her belt back in the day when they had, not to give Shirley's age away too much, but when they had the ladies pro bowlers tour, they had regionals back in the 90s, she had a couple of those under her belt as well, so lots of experience for Shirley here. It should come in handy later on in the match.
Well, you know, she's got 13 300s and a high series of 824.
Wow.
And unfortunately, on middle of the road, got a little bit in the middle. It's going to take off, and she chopped off the three from the 610.
Yep. Well, second year in a row, Katie Saffold has made it on with her team, the Hot Shots, to the 2+1 trios. And Katie, I've known she was one of our youth challenge bowlers back when we first started, and graduated from UW-Whitewater. She's got a pretty nice job down in the Chicago area as an accountant, and does a lot of traveling overseas. Doesn't get the chance to bowl as much as she likes, but with shots like that, you can tell she's got great fundamentals.
Yeah, she does. Five steps. Kind of reminds me very much body build wise and footwork wise of Karen Dorn Ballard going to the line. Real similar positions.
Well, here's somebody I'm pretty familiar with too. We mentioned U Challenge bowlers made their way out of the series. Well, Sam was on our very first show 5 years ago and finally makes it back on another one today. And what power behind that shot?
I just call him Mr. Strike. Every time I watch him throw, it's a strike, Phil.
Yeah, I mean, last year in the Sport League during the summer that I bowled in at New Berlin Bowl, and you were there to watch that night, 831 for a three-game series on a sport condition, on the World Tempin Bowling Association Mexico City pattern. So we know Sam can play. We know Russ can play here. He's got plenty of titles under his belt, too. And you can see the lefties can play a little farther out in this pattern than the righties can.
Yeah, and you know, nice start double, quick start double out of them, and you know, and that takes the lead real quick, and like very much of a down and in type of game. And good friend here, Marcus, and we drill for Marcus, and works out at New Berlin. And short backswing height, we've been working on trying to get his backswing up a little higher, but very, very good rotation and turn on the ball and pulled it a little bit, jumps with the nose.
Yeah, very similar between Russ and Marcus here. When you look at their forms, Russ also had the very short down, very short backswing, and generated just a little more speed than Marcus, and that was probably the difference between the strike Russ had and the 4-7 Marcus has here.
Well, for the viewers, we're, the bowlers are bowling on middle of the road, and that plays like 4.5 to 1, and we're seeing a lot more of the tournaments right now in the area going to a 4-to-1 ratio. Men's state tournament this year that was up in Wausau was on 4-to-1. We know for a fact that the Town and Country tournament at Burlington, Merle puts out a 4-to-1 ratio out there.
Yeah, it's scoreable. You have to make good shots. You don't have to make great shots like in a sport pattern, but you have to make good shots. And even with a good shot by Steve right there, sometimes his good shots just leave those weak tens.
The other thing I see Phil playing on the middle of the road or a 4-to-1 ratios is you have a lot of different angles to the pocket. Strokers will play more of the down and in. The crankers will get into third, fourth arrow, and it gives you a lot of different options on a 4-to-1 ratio.
See Steve switch to that polyester ball. Nice and across the lane, no problem covering that up.
And you can see even for that spare ball, there's a lot of rotation and turn on the ball. He's got a very strong cupped wrist at the bottom of the swing.
Once again, Kunes Country Auto Group sponsoring our 2+1 trios this year. I want to thank them, first tournament they sponsored with us. I want to thank them for coming on board. And both of my cars I own actually purchased back in Kunes about 3 or 4 years ago. So they did a great job service-wise for me. Follow-up after the sale has always been phenomenal. So if you're looking for a New Year's vehicle, make sure you go check them out.
Big break out of Shirley there, almost leaving a 4-6, tripping out the 6 at the last second. That could have really spelled doom for the team early. So she got a big break there. Ball tends to look to me like it set up a little early and then just kind of just skid through the pins. Wasn't really getting that skid, hook, snap type of motion. So let's see if she covers it up.
Yeah, I mean, 40-foot pattern of oil that leaves 20-foot of dry, and a lot of stuff can happen if you're off just a little bit on the shot. Covers it up nicely. So, Lake Geneva Lanes, first time we've been here for any of our Essential Bowling Concepts events. Tom Yankee, the pro shop owner here, who really helped us get everything set up, and I want to thank him and all the staff here at Lake Geneva Lanes for having us, hosting us, and we'll see what Katie can do here, getting into the commercial break.
Again, a little bit fast with the feet, short backswing height, but a nice trip four off the wall again, Phil.
She'll take those trip fours all day, Dwight. We're going to get into our first commercial break here. Join Dwight and I back from Lake Geneva Lanes for more of the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios in just a couple of moments. Four frames in the books here at the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios, and Dwight, Sam Figarino's really got to help his team get back in the chase here.
Well, he struck last time up on lane 13 and in the second frame, and let's see if he can reproduce it. And big dinner bucket break up there, and most of the pins still on the deck, but Mr. Strike gets another strike.
Yeah, I mean, you just see the power of Sam has there to hit the pocket light and just watch the head pin do a lot of work there. Takes out the 6, the 9, almost rolls out the 3 pin. Great shot there by Sam. Let's see if Russ can match him here. Russ struck his first time up as well, and these lefties seem to have that nice line up the outside part of the lane today, and they kind of work together, keep that shot a little bit open. And Russ doesn't get the same break Sam got there. Headpin just didn't do a lot of work.
Yep, light into the pocket, almost left the 5-10, got the 5 out, big break, should be able to cover up that 10 pin very easily.
Yeah, that 5-pin got blocked by the head pin, even though it really wasn't moving that hard out of the way. So,
and again, Lake Geneva Lanes, wood approaches, and then the HPL 9000 AMF synthetic lane panels, which is most of the centers in town are going with, combination-wise.
And a nice cover there by Russ, keeping his team at a 22-pin lead.
Marcus is throwing the crossroad that we drilled for him. And crossroad made by Storm is going to be what we label as one of the big hooking polish balls. Got that one a little wide, Phil, and paid the price.
It looked like he didn't come out of that one real clean either. His ball rotation looked a little funny going down the lane, like he just, the thumb came out early. And it doesn't take much of a miss on this pattern.
No.
To leave a washout. And these really guys were cut out from now, because trying to get that ball across to the head pin, we'll see what he does here.
Yeah, you can see all the lefties are playing quite out, and a lot of the slipped on that one too, Phil.
And that probably cost him the spare right there, losing his balance.
Yeah, no doubt.
And a huge lead now for Hot Shots with Steve Fischer getting up for them.
And again, look at Steve's line here, and the experience I've had on 4-to-1, I have played kind of like Steve's line, a little bit more inside that fourth arrow, a little bit of a swing belly shot, and nice late 10 pin there.
Yeah, making sure every camera got that. We got that for you, Steve. Don't worry. We may even get your replay here in a second. Here we go. So watch that head pin come across, couple skips, couple hops, and puts that 10 pin to bed.
Steve doing a little Hollywooding there. And so
hey, don't blame
him.
Nice
to see. Absolutely.
So, yeah, Steve's had personality. He made the show last year with Katie and their other teammate from last season, Steve Lemke, down in Texas now, because his wife Amber got the head coaching job at Stephen A. Austin down there. So, and just another tug by Shirley.
Yeah, she's just not getting the ball motion, at least to get to the pocket. And knowing Shirley, I know that's probably bothering her, and it would be bothering me too. But again, we talked about it with the juniors a few weeks ago, Phil. In this trios format, you don't have a lot of time to get lined up. You got to make moves real quick and watch your ball reaction, and the game goes by fast.
Yeah, and trust your teammates. If your teammates see something that, you know, to make a move on, you may have to make it. They might see something that you miss out there. And
absolutely.
There's a lot of trust going on between these three team members each. Well, let's see what Katie Saffold can do here. She's got two strikes so far. She's got a couple of trip fours. Something tells me she might be moving a board left with her feet.
Well, you know, I mean, how long can you trip out that four pin before it comes back and snake bites you? So we'll see if she did move a little bit more in. Very nice game. Again, similar to that Carolyn Doran Ballard fast feet. And maybe she made too much of a move there in and caught a little bit too much oil and leaves 2-4-5.
Yeah, caught it just a hair right, didn't get that ball to come back in the pocket, and goes to that soccer ball.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting spare. There's all those neat spare balls out there.
Yeah, a few years ago, Storm got into the novelty balls and made a soccer ball, and they made a basketball, football, and kind of cool going down the lane seeing that a cowl type of pattern with the white and black.
Okay. Remember, Katie, she's always had interesting spare balls since her days at UW-Whitewater. And I'll tell you what, though, she's got one heck of a spare game. She always has had it. She was a great bowler in college. And like I said, with her being on the road a lot and not bowling as much as she'd like to nowadays, the spare game is key for her. And Sam just got right on that.
Yeah, he did. And, you know, here I beefed him up and called him Mr. Strike. And he let me down on that shot, Sam.
I think Sam kind of knew on that one, too, is either strike or the match is over. I mean, with the number of pins that they're down right now, he's just going to heave it down there, try to bounce something out, which doesn't happen. And this match, yeah, it's about over. It's a 50-pin lead now for Hot Shots with their three frames to go. Yeah.
Yeah, again, in that one-game format, when you're Baker type of style with the trios, again, a couple opens can really lower the score quite quick, especially when you're not lined up.
So, interesting start by Russ. Really almost has his left foot perpendicular in his stance to his right, and he was quick on that shot to leave that washout.
Mm-hmm. Starts off way open with his feet, and then kind of lifts and pulls up out of the shot a little bit at the finish. Doesn't drive his body down. If anything, he's very, very stiff-legged with his slide knee at the finish. But you can tell that he's done it a long time and has perfected the current way that he bowls. He's very comfortable with his style.
Yeah, another bowler. We get a lot of bowlers that come up here that go to Rich Blake at Chicago Bowler Shop, and he's another one that Rich and his wife Rochelle's made a couple of our TV shows as well. So they couldn't make the tournament this year. They were out in Baton Rouge for the national USBC National Tournament, so hopefully we'll see the Blakes back next season. And a great shot by Marcus.
Yes, back in there, and unfortunately a little too late, but it's nice to see him at least pound one into the 1-2 pocket.
Well, let's see if Steve does an area check here. He knows the match is pretty well wrapped up right here. I mean, it just takes good count between himself and Katie, even if Shirley was a strikeout. So.
Yeah, two shots. He's hit the pocket. He left the weak 10 on one and then had the late 10 go out on the second one, and that one there was no doubt on.
Yeah, he got that one a little left, but enough oil in the middle of the lane still, even at a 4-1 ratio, to have that ball hold pocket, carry it out. So Hot Shots is going to advance to the next match. Wrangler gang is going to go home in fourth place. And for a team that actually put themselves together only a couple of days before the tournament, bowled very well. They were leading qualifiers and had a little trouble in match play the semifinal part of the tournament and held on to fourth place. And unfortunately, that's where they're going to finish, especially after that bad break for Shirley.
I always look at it as anytime you have a chance to make the TV finals, you bowled good that day. It just wasn't in the cards, at least during the TV show. They have nothing to feel bad about, at least getting this far.
So she's going to give it her best shot here. That Lord Field ball, new ball company out. They're from Korea. They're starting to get some representation around here. Shirley's one of the first reps I've heard of for them around here. And I'm sure she's going to want another chance to get on TV sometime soon.
Absolutely.
So Hot Shots moving on to the next match against Classic Greenfield. Paul and Dianne Cronce and Steve Biskupski, you see them practicing over on Lane 8, getting ready for the match. See if Katie can make a statement for her team here to finish out strong and 10 back.
Yeah, she really got nice motion on that one and then really posted her finish quite nicely on that one. She knew as soon as it was off her hand that the ball was in the pocket.
So handshakes going around and back. See, you can see Sam back there. He's a little dejected. He always likes making these TV shows. I mean, ever since he made our first one. And last time he was on, he won the adult youth doubles at our kickoff classic with Alex Fischer. Pardon me, no, he was in second place in that one. I apologize for that. And he's going to end up in fourth place today.
Very strong trios team, the Wrangler gang. On paper, you would think that they would have dominated this match. And wow, big trip into the four there. A little softer on her speed, that one. That one took off at the very end. But, you know, I mean, the match is over, and so obviously she'll take a strike like that.
Yeah, you can see that smile there. She knows she kind of got away with a little something, a little high, and it's so pretty when the four bounces over and trips out the nine.
It sure is.
I never get those. Well, I'm left-handed, so I get it when the six trips out the eight.
Right, but you never get those either, yeah. Right, Phil?
No, I got to admit, I get one or two of those here and there.
Unfortunately, the good breaks like that don't add up to the bad breaks of leaving the cold eights and the cold tens. Our game, unfortunately, is 90% of the cold eights and the cold tens.
Exactly.
But it keeps us coming back, though.
Always back for more, and Hot Shots can be back for our next match against Classic Greenfield after their 225-147 win. Join Dwight and I back from Lake Geneva and Lanes for more of the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios after this short break.
Well, bowling fans, we're here at 10 Pin Lounge in Chicago. We're watching the PBA Summer Shootout tapings going on. We're not going to give you any spoilers now. You're going to have to start watching those ESPN shows starting on July 7th to see who wins this great competition. All I can tell you so far, it's been a lot of exciting, and every ball counts. Our friends at the PBA Tour let us talk to the bowlers at the Summer Shootout between rounds. We asked them some interesting questions, and here's the question of the week this week. What is your favorite memory as a youth bowler?
You know, growing up, I bowled a lot of youth tournaments, but this one moment stood out. It was one of the first tournaments I ever bowled. A kid that I was really good friends with at the time needed a spare to win, and he missed a spare. My mom screamed, yes, 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 like she didn't know any better. It was very embarrassing to me, but it's something I'll always remember.
Best bowling memory was definitely when I won Junior Olympic gold. I won the very first Junior Olympic gold that they had in 1998. So I was the first Junior Olympic gold national champion, and that was the first year that they actually had a junior Team USA, which was awesome, like actual qualifying for a junior Team USA. So it was really neat to be a part of that inaugural event.
The first time I shot an honor score, it was I was 15 years old, and I shot 299 in a summer league. I left a four pin. That was my first time I really flirted with having a big score and all the nerves associated with, and I threw it pretty good, just not good enough.
From when I was a youth bowler, my best bowling memory is probably winning the Youth Masters. Today it's called the Teen Masters, Gary Beck's tournament. I won the first tournament they ever ran when I was 16 years old. Won a $5,000 scholarship, and thought it was huge. Nowadays, the kids are getting $30,000 and $40,000 scholarships, but that was definitely my best memory from junior bowling.
Thanks again to the PBA Pros for answering our questions this week. And we'll be back with more of the Kunes 2+1 Trios from Lake Geneva Lanes in just a moment. Back for the semifinals of the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios here. Hot Shots moved on from the opening match, taking on Classic Greenfield, our number two qualifiers today. And Dwight, after that big game for Hot Shots, mm-hmm. and Classic Greenfield sitting around, you kind of got to give a favorite label here to Katie Saffold's team.
But interesting philosophy here, Phil, is that Diane's and Paul's team ended up moving Katie's team to the other lane.
So,
a higher qualifier.
Yep. I mean, both teams did get practice on the respective lanes before the match started, and I think Katie needed one more ball of practice there.
Yeah, I think it's a pretty smart move. They're lined up, and they all have a pretty good look on lane 14. Let's move them to 13 and see if they can get lined up there.
Yeah, I mean, when we had the New Berlin 2+1 Trios with the Youth Challenge Series, our final match, Jacob Kent and Amanda Garavet and yes. Mason Petrin could have gotten moved by the other team. They were left on lane 20 on 22, and they just ran away with that game the last game. So,
yeah.
First look here on TV for Dianne Cronce.
Again, amazing, that's the first look on TV.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of experience. I mean, I used to bowl with her back in the day at Strakota's Millshore 20 years ago, so not to give away our ages at all again. But I think she wants that shot back. A little bit of the nerves there. You can see she's a little tight coming back.
No doubt.
Pointing at there's cameras. Yeah, she's pointing at the cameras. So, first time under the lights is never easy. It's just a matter of...
Yeah. She turned around and she's like, that's my first ball on TV. That's what it'll be remembered for.
Yeah.
So I'm sure she'll make this spare. She's a great bowler.
I think that relaxed her a little bit, so hopefully. And it's coming a little high and just gets the three pin off for that spare.
A spare is a spare.
So she'll breathe a little sigh of relief coming back. And, well, she's got three more shots she's going to pull off out here at least. So hopefully we'll see at least a strike or two out of her.
I'm sure she'll get quite comfortable with the setting. Yeah. If not, Paul will help her out.
Well, Russ DeCaluwe here. Struck two out of three times in the opening match. See what he can do here. Moving over to lane 13. Picks up right where he left off.
Very, very fast ball speed. Doesn't get you in trouble a lot because obviously the faster the speed, the more the direct line. Straight is great.
Exactly. Well, first look here at hubby Paul Cronce, the second best bowler in the Cronce family, in my opinion.
Yeah, great. Great guy. Has had the same type of physical game for a long time. Has that little bit of a hop at the finish, but he's had that forever. And just does, bowls a lot of tournaments with Dianne, and it's just a very nice couple.
Yeah. Gets a big break to just leave the four there. You see that ball go real high. Head pin, three pin, pardon me, comes all the way back across the deck and takes that seven pin out.
Again, trying to play that inside line, throwing the Brunswick Evil Siege. Got a good break, leaving only just a four pin.
Paul likes taking the scenic route at a lot of his spares, which we see him do here.
Yeah, I tend to do that too. I tend to hook at my fours and sevens, and sometimes it can get you into trouble depending on the condition. But again, it's the spare shooting. It's what you're comfortable with.
So Steve Fischer had a couple of solid strikes as well last game for Hot Shots. Had that nice messenger in the sixth frame that really got the match. That was a differential in that first game for sure.
Yeah, he actually hit the pocket every shot he was on lane 14 and starts off on lane 13, leaving the six pin crossing over. So a very smart move with Paul and Dianne and Steve moving the other team over to lane 13.
Yeah, I mean, you can see Steve went high, Katie went high, so now both those righties are definitely have to make some type of move. Russ seems pretty well in his comfort zone there. So
far it's affected the right side quite a bit more. And again, that's what I've noticed, Phil, Bowen, in my experiences on 4-1, is even one lane plays completely different than the other, and we're seeing it clearly here, too.
Yeah. And you would think last match, with a pretty fresh oil pair of lanes, you know, there were two lefties on that pair and only right. one on that lane and only one righty, but yet we're watching that lane hook more, as you said.
Right, and again, you could call it topography. Who knows what it may be, Phil. But if the lanes are oiled, the same from 4-1 from one lane to the other, you would think the ball motion would be the same from one lane to the other, and clearly you can see it's not.
Now, that was kind of interesting for Steve because he lost that off his hand early, but yet the way his swing plane went, still went left, and it hooked early on him, and he's lucky to just leave a 3-6-10.
Yeah, it looks to me like the ball wants to kind of check up in the heads, especially if you miss a little bit to the left. But the problem then is if you trust it to the right, then it ain't going to come back.
Yeah, we saw that with Dianne's first shot, definitely. It got right, and it had no prayer coming back.
Yeah, 4-1 can really bring a lot of people to their knees. You got to really play the lanes correctly, and the biggest thing is making your spares too, like Steve did. Great cover.
And three not great shots, really, for the Classic Greenfield team right now, but because they made their spares, they're up by eight pins.
Yes, so important.
I think Katie's going to bounce back here. I'm sure she's going to move her feet a little bit. You can see she's moved a little bit to the left there on the approach. Looks like a couple of boards from where she threw the first frame.
And a nice thing with this type of format, I'm sure there's a lot of conversation and a lot of talk between shots, between your teammates, and I'm sure you can get a lot of help from the men in this situation too. Maybe a little overcorrection there, or it looks to me she just got it a little wide of her target or her mark.
Yeah, you can see the ball was still making its transition from hook to roll right there when we got the close-up on the slow-mo camera, and just didn't have enough on it. Should be no problem with the spare here. Yeah.
Love the, especially for a petite woman as she is, I love the fast feet because that's what's really generating the ball speed. And she has very nice ball speed. Her speed and rev rate match up very well. Dianne is very slow with her feet. As you can see, it's just classic four steps. Has nice rotation and turn on the ball, though. Got it, again, just got it a little wide and didn't want to come back on that 4-1 ratio.
Yeah, and Dianne, a late start in bowling. She didn't start bowling until she was 18 years old.
18.
So, yeah, once she was out of high school and started bowling then, and she really made, you know, a quick progression through the sport. And when she was in her early 20s, she was averaging 200. So let's see if she can cover this up. She just misses it. We're going to get into the commercial break for this match. Join Dwight and I back from Lake Geneva Lanes for more of the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios after this short break. Into the fifth frame here at Lake Geneva Lanes for the semifinal match to the 2012 Kunes Country 2+1 Trios. And Dwight, Russ DeCaluwe has been the most consistent bowler getting to the pocket out of these bowlers on the pair.
Yep, and I just wonder again, obviously accuracy plays a role, but I just wonder what that little higher ball speed he has, and that's down and in line. It doesn't get you into trouble as much, and beautiful 10-back strike there, and so he struck on both the second and the fifth frame. He's done his job.
Yeah, and he struck 2 out of 3 times the first game as well, so his carry percentage when he hits the pocket is 100%, and 4 out of 5 shots right in the pocket. Can't go wrong with that. I'll sign him up for my team next time.
And they're down a little bit now, so Paul's kind of got to get it going here a little bit. They're down by 6 pins. Got it a little wide, and look at that ball just hanging out there, Phil.
You can see the oil's all the way down the outside, down to 40 feet. League bowling, we've seen it before. House shots, some of the terms we've had on house shots, that ball would get outside and it would just overreact sometimes, even and go through the nose, it would overreact so hard. With the lane pattern out here today, he's lucky he didn't leave a washout. He's lucky he's just got the 1-2-4-8, and that's no piece of cake either, Dwight, with that sleeper.
No, absolutely not. I get a little to the right, it's going to stay to the right, and if you get it a little to the left, like almost happened there, it will want to take off, and very lucky to make that spare, just catching a little bit of that head pin on the left side.
Yeah. Let's see what Steve can do here. Steve, right through the nose on his first shot, actually crossed over a little bit.
Yeah.
So, you know, he's going to be probably trying to make a, he'll make a target move. He'll get his target out to the right with his speed and rev rate.
You can clearly see he moved quite a bit more in, but almost maybe not enough, Phil.
Yeah, that ball definitely needed to get a little more right. And when you leave a Greek church like that, at least for a good thing for his team, it's on a strike. So he's got a chance to get, you know, 3 or 4 more pins here, hopefully.
It's just got to be probably frustrating him like crazy because he's lined up on 14. And they move him over to 13, and now he's 0 for 2 for hitting the pocket.
Well, tried spinning something around there to get that 4-7 out, didn't pull it off, and now the lead goes right back to classic Greenfield.
Just one quick big open like that, and look how that just changes the match completely.
Yeah, I mean, Steve wasted no time getting up on the approach. He knows this shot's pretty big for his team here.
You can see he also starts off with his feet quite open to the right, as you can see, trying to project that ball out to the right, especially if the ball wants to set up a little early. And very straight, direct line, and playing the correct type of line, more of an inside angle, especially when the outsides have that much oil in there.
You know, and the funny thing is that as soon as Steve got done with his little celebration here, the first thing he did, went back and talked to Dianne and tell him what he did on that shot so she can kind of mirror him.
Absolutely.
She doesn't have the same rev rate, but her speed's pretty similar to Steve's.
Right. Hey, Dianne, there's nothing outside, move in.
Yep. Well, Katie's had a pretty good shot inside most of the day today. Let's see what that does for her. And 10 back, nicely done.
Yes, great shot, and the team needed it at this point. Keep the match close.
Well, let's see what Dianne can do here, because working on that strike, getting a double here, moves that lead up to 18 pins. And she looks a little more calm here in the seventh frame than she did in the first.
I will not ever bring up my story, even though a lot of people will. The first time I was on Bowling with the Champs, it was a very unforgettable moment.
And yeah! How about an unforgettable moment right there?
Holy cow.
Rolls the two pin out.
Yeah, 2-4-5 was there for a long, long time.
Yeah. Watch the replay here. The head pin backs up after hitting the 5 and takes the 2 out. That's amazing.
I just can't believe that it had enough momentum to take that 2 out. Wow.
Well, that's a game changer there,
big
no doubt.
Double. Yes, big, big double.
Because you know, with Russ's track record here, it's probably going to be a strike. Right on line, and jeez.
You can sit down now, Russ.
He's done for the game. That's exactly it. He's done for the game. He's did his job. 3 strikes and 3 attempts this game.
3 beautiful strikes, absolutely. And it shows you that direct line, especially on a tighter pattern, that pays your dividends.
And that keeps his team within 8 pins, and let's see what Paul can do here to get that lead back out to 18. Little creeper up to the line, but his head stays nice and steady until he gets to that jumpy follow-through and weak into the pocket with that 10.
Yeah, he threw a good shot. It's just that Evil Siege just didn't have enough on that last 10 feet to kick out that weak 10.
See if we get a replay here on that. Yep, and you just watch the ball deflect when it hits the pocket. Goes almost out all the way through the 9-pin spot. And yeah, it's tough to carry when your ball deflects that much.
Yeah, probably wish he had a little bit more angularity on that last 10 feet or had a ball that gave him a little bit more of that last 10 feet, but nice cover there for the spare.
And that's huge right now because it's going to force Steve Fischer to get up here and strike for hot shots to take the lead. And he struggled his first 2 shots.
Yes, I don't think he's still comfortable on lane 13 and lined up on 13, leaving a Greek church the last time up there. I'm sure that's in his mind.
And that just doesn't get far enough right again. And he goes, he's lucky to just leave the 3-6-10, something makeable.
Yeah, absolutely. And
the frustration is evident for Steve right now.
Yeah, and he moved in, and the ball still took off. At that point, you got to start thinking ball downing. You got to ball down, got to go to a weaker shell. You got to get something that's going to give you more length, because obviously everything you're throwing is checking up early. And, Phil, this is not an easy spare on middle of the road. And
wow.
Chops it off.
Unbelievable. And that just increases the lead for Classic Greenfield to 24 pins like that. Steve is just not happy with himself right now.
No.
And you just see how much that ball hooked the last 3 or 4 feet to chop the three off the rest.
Yeah, that was almost a strike line. That would eventually have ended up being a strike line.
So let's see what Steve can do here and put the nail in the coffin for hot shots if he can set up Dianne in the 10th. Nicely online and just a tad high.
Yeah, he liked it. Maybe it's touch soft on the speed compared to his last shot, but that's definitely not going to get him in trouble, especially if he covers it up.
Well, and without striking right there, it leaves the possibility of Katie striking out in the 10th frame and forcing Dianne to mark. So Steve knew that was a big ball right there.
Yes, absolutely. And it was not a bad shot. It was around the pocket. Could have got the trip 4. Covers it up quite nicely. Spares are big.
Spares are huge right now, and except for Katie here. She's got to start throwing strikes. She needs to throw 3 of them to force Dianne Cronce from Classic Greenfield to mark in the 10th frame to move on to the finals against Jamie Cullen's team. And Jamie's team is in the finals for the 3rd year in a row, and she's looking to get away from all those second place finishes in this tournament.
Well, she's lined up pretty good. I mean, she struck the last time on the lane, and I'm sure she'll be around the pocket on this shot, too. Beautiful form. Beautiful
right down the line, and a nice mixer.
Wow, very impressive game. Very nice little game.
So, yeah, I want to thank Kunes Country Auto Group down in Delavan. Check them out if you're looking for a new or used vehicle. They've got great sales going on right now. Like I said, I've bought my last 2 vehicles there, and I'm happy with the after-sales service is what really counts for me, and they do a great job down there for me.
Leaving that lasting impression.
And is Katie going to leave a lasting impression on the 10 pins right now? Oh, no. Kind of an inconsequential break right now because she needed a strike or nothing on that. So
any chance of winning that match, she had to have the second one. And so looking up at the score, she knew how important that 11th frame was.
Yeah, so right now all they have to do really is just Diane's just got to get up and stay behind the foul line with good count because the maximum here is 166 for hot shots. Which she gets nicely. Right now with a 9 count out, it's 178 for
correct.
Or 177 for Classic Greenfield. So they're gonna move into the final match against Team Eagle, Jamie Cullen's team, and I'll tell you what, Jamie's hungry for that victory. And with the way that Classic Greenfield's kind of struggled here, even with Dianne Strike right there, I gotta make Team Eagle the favorite next match.
Well, they had only one open. They stayed out of trouble. They weren't lined up 100%, but they stayed out of trouble, made their spares, big spares, and obviously are moving into the final.
Yeah, only one open for Classic Greenfield this game, Dianne's 4th frame, and you know, 3 opens, hot shots, and that was the difference.
It would have been interesting to see if the KD's team would have been able to stay on lane 14 if they would have ended up making this match closer, could have possibly won. So it was great strategy by Steve, Dianne, and Paul to move them to lane 13,
yeah, I mean,
I think.
Yeah, exactly. And with Jamie's team coming on, they'll have lane choice, and something tells me Jamie's team is going to take lane 14. With the first 2 matches won in that lane, you know they're going to move the other team. I have no doubt in my mind. We're going to get back to a commercial break here from Lake Geneva Lanes for the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios. Dwight and I will be back with the final match from here in just a couple of moments, so make sure you stay tuned.
Kunes Country Chevrolet Cadillac is having a construction reduction sales event.
Because of your support, we're growing to serve you even better.
Our inventory selection is the largest in the state line area.
With our exclusive live market-based pricing, you'll find the right vehicle at a price and payment you can afford.
From Burlington to Harvard.
From Janesville to Kenosha.
We're a family-owned dealership where taking care of our customers is job one.
So from our family to yours, now you're in Kunes Country.
The championship match for the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios. little roundabout handshake there, get everybody in at once to get this match started. And Dwight, we talked about it at the end of the last match. And Jamie Cullen's team came on, they had lane choice, and what did they do?
Mm-hmm.
Move the other team over to lane 13.
Mm-hmm. You would think, again, Phil, on paper, that you know that's a smart move, and the righties are hitting 14 pretty good, so it'll be interesting to see what happens during this match with the changeover to 13. I don't think 13's got the nice look for the right-handed side, and see what I mean about the insides being drier?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, she's doing a little bit about her footwork there, but that was more of a little bit of nerves and a little bit of left.
Yeah,
and that was, and there you could see the lack of hold in the middle.
Yeah.
League shot that's gonna, that might skate all the way to the pocket for her, but today, no, it doesn't even get close to the head pin.
Yeah. I would have to, if I was on 13, I'd be deep.
Ooh, wow. That really read early on top of being left.
Yeah.
Which is probably a symptom of being a little left on left the target, but
yeah,
Diane's just going in back right now and just going,
I'm gonna go
get the nerves. Yeah. Yeah. You can see Steve talking to her back there, trying to get her line back up. And here's a young woman that doesn't need much help getting lined up whenever we've seen her on TV before. She probably makes, every time there's a woman involved in a essential bowling concept telecast, she's on that show.
What can you say about it? Great game. Bowled against her in the three-man league over at Bolero on Wednesdays. It's been around a long time. A lot of experience on TV. Getting a little crap for leaving the five pin, I take it, from her teammates.
Well, that and don't miss it on TV. That's
yes,
the thing.
The
so,
rolls.
Yeah, so you see everybody helping her out there.
I feel like I'm on a Marquette Golden Eagles game.
And she's looking it down. No problem. Covers it up. Safe sign goes up. So
nice to see a lot of the fun between the teammates. That's great.
Well, that's exactly it. I mean, these six bowlers have bowled against each other in all kinds of things, tournaments all over the place. They know each other pretty well. And yeah, even though it was a $690 first place prize for the winning team today, along with some Brunswick bowling balls, I'll tell you what, you know, the blood and the will to win is still out there for these two teams.
Absolutely, but they're mixing it up real nice, having a lot of fun with it too. Paul playing a little bit farther in, staying with the Evil Siege, and nice shot.
Really picked up his speed from over when he was on lane 14. You can
no
see
doubt.
That shot.
Yeah, he threw it pretty hard on that one. Let's see if he can maintain that speed throughout the game, but great starting off first shot.
So, Rob Milbrath, we saw him most recently on the Action Heating and Cooling Team Shootout. Himself and Jerry were on the winning Town and Country number one team.
Mm-hmm. Known Rob forever, drilled for Rob for quite some time. Great physical game, a lot of speed, a lot of rev rate, very free arm swing, just a very talented bowler.
His other interests outside of bowling are golf and pleasing his wife, Tracy. So we wanted to make sure
nice.
That we're going to get that in the air. So, Tracy, you can use that the rest of your life. It's on TV. It's now official.
I was reading Diane's bio, and I loved what she said. Interests out of bowling, volleyball, golf, and drinking, Phil. In that order. Like the last one there.
Covers it up nicely. Moves on. Keeps a 12-pin lead for Team Eagle. So there's you know after the game's done today, there's gonna be a couple adult beverages, and
as Rob said
at the end of the Action Heating and Cooling Team Shootout, a couple barley pops will be had.
In Paul's case, it's Jägermeister. He writes on his, in that order too, golf, bartending, and Jägermeister in that order. So
they may have to get some new hobbies later on. Let's see what Steve can do here. This should be right in Steve's wheelhouse. We saw Paul pick up his speed. Steve naturally throws it pretty hard. That's right on line for him. 10 back.
Staying right, though. Real interesting. You would think that he would be farther in, but because of the higher speed, staying in the track area, I thought he would be super deep, but so far so good.
Well, maybe they took a page from Russ on the left side. Straighter was greater for Russ all day, and now we got everybody playing the lanes a little straighter on 13. Could be right in Classic Greenfield's wheelhouse. Everybody knows Jerry Riemer. Mm-hmm. If you've been at Town and Country Lanes, you know his wife Teresa and his father-in-law Merrill.
Yeah, great people out there.
So,
and again, I've drilled for Jerry since he was in juniors, and always been that power player type of game. But pitched it a little to the right and didn't come back. But very strong team, obviously, between Rob and Jerry and
Jamie's holding things in there for him. Well, let's see if Jerry can get that all covered up, which he does. The 1-2-4. So
So with that, even though Team Eagle's got three spares on the board, the low counts gives Classic Greenfield the lead by one pin with Dianne coming up in the fourth frame.
Let's see if she can bounce back from that 1-3-6 in the first frame.
Much better shot.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Oh, gets the Wally, so nice three-bagger and 4-1 ratio and showing off a little bit there. Thank you very much.
Yeah, she picked up her speed and she moved a little farther right, and you just see the ball do a lot of the work. The head pin does a lot more and gets everything out. And 900 Global staffer here for Jaime Cullen. Told her I'd make sure that got on the air this time. She's been a staffer with them for a couple of seasons now.
Beautiful form. Kind of reminds me a lot of my daughter with the follow-through.
We're going to have to get to a quick commercial break here from the championship match of the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios, so make sure you stay tuned after this break. Four frames in the books here at Lake Geneva Lanes, the Kunes Country 2+1 Trios, and Dwight Paul Kranz up working on a team three-bagger.
Yep, could put the team 22 pins ahead with this strike, currently up by 12. Last time struck on that lane.
Oh my.
Excuse me?
Yeah, exactly. Caves in the big four.
What happened there?
I don't know.
4-6 was there for a split second.
Let's get a replay here. Yeah, it comes up very high and you just see.
Wow.
He trips the 4-7 with the 2 and the 3 pin comes back off the wall and takes out the 6-10, and Rob's going to be thinking to himself on the approach, what do I got to do to carry a shot?
When I'm bowling against an opponent, I don't want to watch the carry. I want to keep my head down. I don't want to see if they got a lucky break or not.
Ooh.
To me, that can affect me psychology-wise, and I'm sure it didn't affect Rob. I'm sure Rob just got a little bit to the right of target on that shot, but I just don't want to see the lucky break. When I'm bowling.
Yeah, you see the frustration. I mean, he went a little wide with his first shot, leaving just the two pin. And now with this, he really needs to make this 1-2-10 in order to keep his team within 30 pins.
And just what we talked about in that one game match, if you have an open, it can change the match very, very quick. There's the open, and now they got 84 in the fifth, Phil. And boy, the other team, just like that, has got a super big lead, 33-pin lead.
Yeah, one frame out of the commercial break, they were sitting with a 20-pin lead. Now if Steve can strike here, they'll double their lead, basically, in two shots.
Yeah, 43 pins. So it can happen that quick in that one-game match. Last time up on this lane, Steve also struck, staying farther out.
Oh!
He stays far out again. A little softer on the speed, trips out the four pin. So two huge back-to-back breaks for Team Classic Greenfield.
And I'll tell you what, sometimes the old saying, I'd rather be lucky than good. Well, in a one-game match, sometimes the lucky breaks is what it comes down to. And you know, Classic Greenfield's got a couple of those in a row right now. And you know that's going to loosen up Dianne's swing next time she's up.
Well, there's no doubt.
And, of course, their team, Jerry, going, why can't my team get that same kind of break? I leave a 9-pin.
And, you know, earlier matches, it looked like 14 was favoring the right-hand side, and now all of a sudden 13 looks like it's favoring the right-hand side. And that's what can happen on 4-1. That's what can happen on patterns like middle of the road. You can be lined up one game and then lost the next. And this year at Men's State Tournament, that was the case for me. I shot 130 one game and then came back 230. And that's what happens, a ball change and a different line, and the next thing you know, you're back in the pocket.
Yeah. Well, Dianne Kranz here, she's 1-for-2 this game so far. Last time she was dead flush in the pocket. And once again, she's throwing the good strikes on that team. I hope the guys give her credit for when she's throwing strikes, they're the 10 flush back in the pit.
Well, it's amazing when you got that double behind you, all of a sudden that next strike for you comes awfully easy. But that's a demanding lead now, 53 pins.
And you're
not many frames left.
Nope. Your 2011 Wisconsin Women's Open champ, Jaime Cullen, also in the 2007 Badger Queens tournament. So lots of tournament titles under her belt as well, and something tells me, even with a bad shot like that, she's going to be a State and City Hall of Famer when she's eligible. She's only 30 years old, so.
I still think they made the right decision, put in the other team on lane 13. Team Classic Greenfield on 13 and Team Eagle on 14. Is just, it transitioned very, very quick for them, and now all of a sudden they don't have the look to the pocket.
So switches to that polyester 900 global ball, and that's not going to get any.
Yeah, it catches that outside oil. It's just going to fall off into the right gutter.
Well, it's a 69-pin lead for Classic Greenfield. Dwight, this one's pretty much about over. So let's see how long the strike streak can go, basically, for Classic Greenfield there.
Absolutely. Last time Paul was up, he got that very lucky strike tripping out the 4-6. Kind of reminded me of one of those strikes, Phil, where they put a strain through the pins and then pull the strain or the rope back to make all the pins fall over in the old days.
Exactly. And no need for the string that time, Dwight.
No, that one, every pin did its job and... raising the blue flags.
Yeah, Rob knows this one's over after that. It's seven in a row for class. If you would have told me that team would have had seven in a row, I would have said spares after the first game they were on TV.
Seven in a row on lane 13, where the other team, the last game, was completely lost on it for the right-hand side. Look how quick one game it can completely turn around.
Yeah, and that's just not getting anywhere. And well, there's one you don't see every day, Dwight, the old 159.
The old 159.
Somebody is saying the crowd here, I've never seen you miss this. Probably because they've never seen him leave it either.
That's right.
So, well, it's basically just a high flush strike shot. It'll take it all three pins out.
Absolutely.
Bad part for Rob is he hasn't been high flush in his three shots in that lane so far.
0 for 3 for hitting the pocket. I'm sure he's not very happy at this point.
Right on line, and yeah, the fist bump goes up.
Can have a little fun at this moment or at this time in the game, obviously, knowing that it's over.
Exactly. I mean, they're still taking home a $510 second place team prize today. So I want to thank Lake Geneva Lanes for getting this all together. If you're near Lake Geneva Lanes all summer long, they've got great bowling specials Thursdays and Sundays. They've got $1 bowling, so especially when the fall bowling seasons are starting, you want to get warmed up again, go down to Lake Geneva Lanes and get some good bowling on some good lanes for cheap.
I think Jerry and Rob should have took Steve Fisher's line, went maybe with a little bit more of a dollar ball and played farther in on 14. It could have possibly been a different format or a different look to the game. They could have got a different, better ball reaction than what they had. They wanted to stay shiny and stay out in the track, and it just didn't give them very good ball reaction.
Steve plays rally killer here when he goes high, leaves the six pin, and then can't get... Well, there's a little oil on the outside, folks, because if you can't get that ball to hook back and take the six pin out, so a little razzing by his team on the way back.
Yeah, there's no way in God's name on this pattern I would play out. I would definitely be playing in. And Jerry played a little bit more in on that shot, and again, the inside looks like a better trajectory to the pocket.
And Jerry's packing up because he's got to, guess what, go bowl another tournament now that he's done here. So you can tell a lot of these bowlers, lots of tournament experience, and yeah, sometimes they even bowl two tournaments in one day. So you know, Jerry's just got to hit the road again and start throwing that ball somewhere else.
Big win for Team Classic Greenfield. Again, wash out there, just got a little to the right, but at this point, Dianne knows that she's a champion, and it's got to feel awfully good standing there.
So, no doubt about that. You know, I think the nerves are finally going away for Dianne. Now, it's probably the second to last or last shot she's going to throw here, depending on if she makes a spare.
Yeah, it's just a great feeling, what I call cruising to the title, and knowing that it was over probably in about the eighth frame.
Yep. 223 game finishes off with an open frame, but when you get that $690 first place prize and those Brunswick bowling balls for winning, you just gotta savor the moment while you have it.
Yes, absolutely. Knowing Jaime and the true professional she is, I'm sure that she will give it all in the 10th frame and continue to keep working on hitting her mark and having the great body positions, and there's the Jaime that we all know.
No doubt. I'm just going to have to remind her here that she's, I'm going to say she's a 900 global staffer.
So,
yep.
I think you mentioned that already, Phil, this game.
I want to make sure we get that. Well, I don't want to thank 900 global, too, because the high qualifiers today for the women and the men, the high qualifying score, they each received a 900 global train bowling ball, and the second high scorers received 900 global two-ball tote bags. So, thanks to Brunswick and thanks to 900 global for all the help they give us, not just with this tournament, but with the Youth Challenge Series as well.
Yep. Young ladies out there watching this show, you want to try to simulate someone, simulate Jaime Cullen. Her body positions at the finish are just beautiful. Spine angles tilted nice and forward. Her head and her shoulders are over that slide knee. And she's got that beautiful heavy forward roll on the ball. Just great, great positions. And there's a reason why she's always in the finals. Just got a great physical game.
Yeah, unfortunately for her, it's going to be another second place finish for her team here at the 2+1 trios. So let's see if she can finish out big. Leaves that A count. We want to thank Kunes Country in Delavan for all their support of the 2+1 trios. We couldn't pay off this great prize fund of the bowlers without them. And Dwight and I will be back from Lake Geneva Lanes to wrap up this show in just a couple of minutes, so make sure you stay tuned.
I have a lot of viewers that ask me, why do you have so many of your tournaments at Castle Lanes? Well, Castle Lanes is a center that has an exceptional atmosphere. The charm of being in a Northwoods cabin while you bowl, an attentive staff on the lanes and in the lounge, all the big screen TVs and a free Wi-Fi hotspot, and being named in Bowler's Journal as one of the 95 places to bowl before you die, you have to bowl at Castle Lanes. That's why we love Castle Lanes, and you will too.
Well, Dwight, we've got the Kunes Country 2+1 trios in the books. You look at that championship match before it started on paper, you got Team Eagle and Classic Greenfield. Team Eagle with the overwhelming favorite, but that's why they get out there and throw the bowling balls.
Yeah, you would think that Jamie and Robin and Jerry would have walked away with this, but you know, Diane's group, Team Classic Greenfield, 7 in a row, Phil, and that just opened up the door for them to walk away with the title.
Yeah, I mean, that match was wrapped up by the time the 8th frame came through. The 9th and 10th frame opens really didn't matter, and Classic Greenfield takes home the $690 first place prize and the Brunswick bowling balls. We've got more bowling action coming up. We're getting back to the U Challenge Series. We're going back to Castle Lanes, the border battle, and we always get great matches between the Wisconsin kids and the Illinois kids.
Yeah, it was nice to see the adults this time, but looking forward to seeing the kids again.
That's it for this show. For my friend Dwight Albrecht, I'm Phil Brilo. Parents hate the kids bowling, the fun for life, and join us again from Castle Lanes for that border battle.